morning, my dear children. This is Somasundari, Social Department. Dear children, today we are discussing about basic concept of India's foreign policy and SAARC. Children, before starting the class, I will ask few questions from previous topic. Are you ready? Okay, let's start. Question number one. The Panjasil Treaty has been signed between. The Panjasil Treaty has been signed between. Answer is India and China. Answer is India and China. Question number two. India conducted its first nuclear test at DAS. India conducted its first nuclear test at DAS. Answer is 1974. 1974. Question number 3. Afro-Asian Conference held in DAS. Answer is Indonesia. Indonesia. Question number 4. The Foreign Service Training Institute located at DAS. The Foreign Service Training Institute located at DAS. Answer is New Delhi. New Delhi. Question number 5. The second nuclear test at Pokhran in DAS. The second nuclear test at Pokhran in DAS. Answer is Rajasthan. Rajasthan. Dear children, I hope you are all got correct answer, isn't it? Okay. Children, now we are discussing about basic concept of India's foreign policy. Foreign policy general objectives that guide the activities and relationship of one state in its interaction with other states. The development of foreign policy is influenced by domestic considerations, the policies or behavior of other states or plans to advance specific geopolitical designs. A country foreign policy, also called foreign relations or foreign affairs policy, consists of self-interest strategies chosen by the state to safeguard its national interest and to achieve good within its international relations. The approaches are strategically employed to interact with other countries. It is almost impossible for any state to live in isolation from international politics in today's world. Interdependences among states has increased tremendously. Consequently, the country's foreign policy has assumed enormous significance, much like its domestic policy. A country's image and prestige, as well as the survival of its government, very often rest on its foreign policy. But a country's foreign policy is not an abstract phenomenon. It is very carefully formulated by the government in the national interest. In India, followed 8 basic concepts of foreign policy. Students, it's very important question. It's very important paragraph question. Keep it in your mind. Listen carefully. India has followed 8 basic concepts, the foreign policy. First one, preservation of national interest. Preservation of national interest. Second one, achievement of world peace. Achievement of world peace. Third one, disarmament. Disarmament. What is the meaning of disarmament? Disarmament means the reduction or withdrawal of military forces and weapons. disarmament means the reduction or withdrawal of military forces and weapons. Fourth one, fostering cordial relationship with other countries. Fostering cordial relationship with other countries. What is the meaning of cordial? Cordial means greeting or sincere. Cordial means greeting or sincere. Then fifth one, solving conflicts by peaceful mean. Solving conflicts by peaceful mean. What is the meaning of conflicts? Conflicts means a serious disagreement or argument. A serious disagreement or argument. Sixth one, independence of thought and action as per the principle of norm. Sixth point of basic concept, independence of thought and action as per the principle of norm. What is the abbreviation of norm? NAM. Its abbreviation is non-aligned movement. Non-aligned movement. Basic concept. Seventh point, equality in conducting international relations. Equality in conducting international relations. The eighth one, anti-colonialism, anti-imperialism and anti-racism. Anti-colonialism. What is the meaning of anti-colonialism? Anti-colonialism means opposed to colonial rule of one country to another. Imperialism is also same. So, anti-imperialism means opposed to the imperialism rule of one country to by another.
Les dépenses militaires s'accroissent et la course aux armements s'accélère au niveau mondial, notamment dans les régions les plus dangereuses. Disarmament concerns every country and all weapons, from hand grenades to hydrogen bombs. Deadly weapons put us all at risk, and leaders have a responsibility to minimize that risk. I appeal to all states, including non-parties, to adhere to the non-proliferation and disarmament obligations and commitments under the NPT. All states, nuclear and non-nuclear, must work together to bridge the gulf that divides them. As armed conflict has moved from open fields into cities, explosive weapons are particularly deadly for civilians. And these weapons also have a devastating effect on hospitals, schools, and water and electricity supplies. If there is a major outbreak of armed conflict in our world, and we all hope there is not, I'm sure that it will be preceded by a massive cyber attack. And I'm prepared to make available my good offices to prevent conflict resulting from acts committed in cyberspace. And social media offers unprecedented tools to connect, to reach across borders, and join with others around the world through campaigns, non-governmental organizations, and online community. The United Nations would like to work with you to help you acquire the knowledge and skills to amplify your voices and lead the change we need. Disarmament prevents and ends violence. Disarmament supports sustainable development. And disarmament is true to our values and principles.
Children, now we are discussing the policy of disarmament. Policy of disarmament. First, what is disarmament? Disarmament is already I told you, isn't it? So once again, disarmament is the act of reducing, limiting or abolishing weapons. Disarmament is the act of reducing, limiting or abolishing weapons. Disarmament generally refers to a country's military or specific type of weaponry. Disarmament generally refers to a country's military or specific type of weaponry. Disarmament is often taken to mean total elimination of weapons of mass destruction such as nuclear arms. The disarmament is needed for the world peace and security, and this is also the main purpose of United Nations. Disarmament is needed for the world peace and security and is also the main purpose of United Nations. So disarmament is needed not only to reduce the danger of war, but to prevent the waste of human and material resources and to strengthen the world peace and security. So disarmament is needed not only to reduce the danger of war, but to prevent the waste of human and material resources and to strengthen the world peace and security. Our tradition and national ethos is to practice disarmament as a peace living nation. India champions the cause of qualitative and quantitative disarmament right from the beginning. India champions the cause of qualitative and quantitative disarmament right from the beginning. Since independence, global non-proliferation has been dominant theme of India's nuclear policy. So India supported UN disarmament program. Indian nuclear program in 1974 and 1998 is only done for strategic purposes. The two themes of India's nuclear doctrine are, first one is no first use, second one credible minimum deterrence. Credible minimum deterrence. It was decided not to use nuclear power for offensive purposes and would never use against any non-nuclear state. It has decided not to use nuclear power for offensive purposes and would never use against any non-nuclear state. India and US civilian nuclear deal marks a significant progress in India's foreign policy. India and US civilian nuclear deal marks a significant progress in India's foreign policy. The need for disarmament in the present day world. Need for disarmament in the present day world. Countries have built their own biological weapons and weapons of mass destruction for security reasons. The only way to control the people and nations from causing a full-scale war would be through disarmament. children, now we are discussing about SARC. S-A-A-R-C. SARC means the South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation. The South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation. SARC is Regional Intergovernmental Organization and Geopolitical Union of States in South Asia. SARC was founded in Dhaka on 8th December 1985. Its secretariat based in Kathmandu, Nepal. The organization promotes development of economic and regional integration. It launched the South Asian Free Trade Area in 2006. They maintain permanent diplomatic relations at the United Nations as an observer and has developed link with multilateral entities including the European Union. SARC have 8 member countries. What are the member of SARC? Its members states are Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, Nepal, Maldives, Pakistan, Sri Lanka and India. There are 8 members in SARC: Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Maldives, Nepal, Pakistan and Sri Lanka. Why was SARC established? The idea was to establish better cultural and social ties amongst the member states to promote peace in this region. It was also intended to promote trade amongst the member in order to improve the economic status of its members and to raise it from a region to poverty to a region of economic and social well-being. What is the motto of SARC? The motto of SARC: deeper integration for peace and prosperity. Deeper integration for peace and prosperity. What is purpose of SARC? The SARC seeks to promote the welfare of the people of South Asia, strengthen collective self-reliance, promote active collaboration and natural existence in various fields, and cooperate with international and regional organizations. SARC Disaster Management Center was set up at New Delhi. Where is SARC Disaster Management Center? The SARC Disaster Management Center set up at New Delhi. Now, I ask few questions. Who is the present chairman of the SARC? The present chairman of the SARC, Arjun Bahadur Daba from Nepal. Who was the first Secretary General of SARC? The first Secretary General of SARC is Mr. Abul Hoshan. Where is SARC Summit 2019? 2019 SAARC Summit 2019 in Sri Lanka. SAARC Summit 2019 in Sri Lanka. Where is SAARC Summit 2020? Where is SAARC Summit 2020? The SAARC Summit 2020 is Islamabad. SAARC Summit 2020 is Islamabad. At present, Secretary General of SAARC. At present, Secretary General of SAARC. Who is present Secretary General of SAARC? Esla Ruwan Wirakun. Esla Ruwan Wirakun. 3rd March 2020. At present, Secretary General of SAARC, Zala Ruwan Wirakun, 3rd March 2020. Which is the official language is SAARC? Which is the official language of SAARC? The official language of SAARC is English. The official language of SAARC is English. Okay, children. I hope you are all understanding this today's topic. Now we are going to end of this session. Children, revise the portion properly. Okay. Next class, I will ask few questions from this topic. So, revise properly. Okay, children. Thank you.